So this is exciting. I got Jesse Felder on. So I got to go from me being in the New York Stock Exchange trading equities right now, to a moon behind me. And also, before I switch, hey, think about it. I won't do it when I'm in the conversation. That's kind of rude when you're interviewing a guy and you're like, can you like and subscribe, please? So here we is. All right, you guys. So I have Jesse here. He is the publisher of the Felder Report. We're going to be going over quite a bit of things on this video. And I think you guys really need to set everything aside, throw it away, stay focused. So Jesse, thank you so much for coming on the channel. I really appreciate it. And for those of you that are like, okay, where are we going? We're going to be talking about the Fed and the huge disconnect that we have between the real economy and the financial economy. So go ahead, Jesse.
My name is Jesse Felder. I started Wall Street probably, 25 years ago, working for Bear Stearns. Did that for a couple of years before I left with my mentor at the firm there. We started our own hedge fund. This was in Los Angeles. I was head trader, co-portfolio manager of a hedge fund for a few years before I quit. In 2000, it was literally March of 2000, the peak of the dot-com mania, and moved out of LA to Bend, Oregon, little Bend, Oregon here where I still live today, and been kind of basically just managing my own money and writing about markets ever since.
Sounds good. I'm from Los Angeles. Same thing. You got out and I stayed. So maybe I'll come up to Oregon. I'm looking to get out. So, I mean, I've been looking to get out. On that, when it comes to like where we're at right now, the real economy, the financial economy, how can you help people to move forward? Because we're all just sitting here scratching our heads going, how are we seeing this? How does this continue? And then with the Fed, things like that.
I mean, you know, it's a good question. I think probably the one thing investors are trying to figure out right now for most people with their portfolios is, you know, what do I do with my money in regards to with everything that's going on? And, you know, if there's one thing that I've learned over the course of my career, and I've learned this through experience, but also from studying some of the greatest investors of all time. And it really boils down to a quote from Jim Rogers for me. One of my favorite books is Market Wizards, and the whole Market Wizards series, is terrific. But Jim Rogers in that book talks about how maybe the most important lesson investors can learn is when there's nothing to do, do nothing. you really only should, feel compelled to do anything with your investments when there's really an attractive opportunity, almost something that's such an attractive opportunity, you can't resist not doing it. So everybody feels like I need to do something. We want to be proactive. But a lot of times that leads us to making bad decisions. And so I think usually it's best to just wait until opportunities arise. And because a lot of the mistakes people make is are trying to make something happen when there's really nothing to be done. And I really do think we're in a place right now where most investors probably should, be conserving cash and not be trying to take on too much risk. Exactly the opposite of what you probably see for a lot of, hear a lot of friends and young people doing right now, which is opening Robinhood accounts and trading, bankrupt stocks. That's probably the exact opposite of what you want to be doing right now, in my opinion.
Yeah. I actually, on my channel, I say it's the Robinhood kids. I'm always making fun of them. And I know it's like Hertz files for bankruptcy. It's like, oh my gosh, we got to go buy it. And then yesterday I did a video Sunday, another bankrupt company. It was the oil, and they just filed for bankruptcy. And it's like, what is everyone? I didn't even look. I don't know what their stock's trading at right now, but I could just see, all the Robinhood kids. It's like, oh, we got another bankruptcy. Let's go buy it.
Yeah.
So yeah,
CHK, buy it. Don't buy it. Don't buy it.
I know. The Robin Hood kids are like, what? Cheesecake Factory filed for bankruptcy? Like, no, you guys, please. Right. Set your phones down. Turn them off.
Well, it's crazy times, and it's literally, I'm 46 years old, so I say kids. My son's 20 years old. And so I think, 20-year-old, he's a kid, but there are a lot of 10, 11, 12-year-olds literally playing the Robin Hood game. They call it the Robin Hood game on their phones. Their parents, fund an account with $500 or something. And they can, there's literally story after story where you have they're literally kids, you know, playing, mm-hmm. playing, feel like it's playing a game in the stock market.
Yeah, I teach high school business too. And, you know, these high school kids just turned 18. They're like, yeah, I'm going to do options. Just like, no,
stop. Yeah. Well, options are, you know, I mean, 90% of people lose money trading options. So, you know, that you have much better odds in Vegas than trying to be an option, an amateur option trader. So.
Oh, I absolutely. Yeah. Yep. And the penny stocks and day trade. I'm going to be a day trader since I can't get a job at, you know, McDonald's. I'm going to be a professional day trader because these kids, you know, they're on Lamborghinis. So they must be doing something right. Okay. So in regards to the Fed. And now everyone hates the Fed, but the truth is, do you fight the Fed or do you work with it?
There's two respects. I mean, in terms of the markets, I think you don't fight the Fed when they are adding an inordinate amount of net liquidity into the markets. And so, but it's important to focus on net liquidity. So everybody thinks, you know, Jay Powell is firing up the money printer. It's time to buy stocks. But you have to look at, Stan Druckenmiller's talked about this, and he's really the most famous person, I think, that has come out in the last few years and said, you know, it's not earnings that move stock prices. It's not any of these fundamental drivers. It's liquidity, and it's the central banks that move markets. And so pay attention to central banks. But Stan came out a couple of months ago and pointed out that, you know, Fed liquidity isn't the only part of that. Net liquidity is much more important. So the Fed comes in, they print money and they buy up treasury bonds or treasury bills or whatever across the whole curve. But at the same time, the treasury is issuing more of these. And so if the Fed is buying more than the treasury is issuing, that's net liquidity going into the markets. But as soon as the treasury starts issuing more than the Fed is buying, that's actually a surplus of excess supply. And so if you just go back to simple supply and demand, right, if demand, you know, stays steady, we're getting a greater supply of these securities, that should be bearish for prices. And so I think that's what a lot of people don't appreciate right now is the Fed is printing. And so you would think don't fight the Fed, but the Fed actually, their balance sheet has actually contracted for the last couple of weeks. So they're actually, you know, reducing the amount of money that they're putting into the system. At the same time, the Treasury, you know, the total national debt is growing at about $200 billion a week right now. So that to me is net $200 billion of negative net liquidity for the financial markets, which is, so don't fight the Fed right now would be actually, okay, well, this is a very bearish picture that the Fed is painting right now. They're not printing nearly enough to support asset prices. So right now, if you take it from that standpoint, don't fight the Fed means don't be buying stocks right here as a trader. You probably want to be, getting out of the way for, you know, some potential downside.
So your suggestion would be right now we're just going to wait. Is that like, if you had to summarize, what do we do? What do we do right now as of today with our investments? If we're in the market, should we not get into the market? What's your take?
My take is, I think for the average investor, you probably want to have a big slug of cash available to take advantage. But because they're debasing the currency so quickly, you need a hedge also. Mm-hmm. And so I've been bullish on gold since summer of 2015. So the last 5 years, gold's had a really good run since then. I don't think it's as terrific as an opportunity as it was, you know, even a year ago. But I think you need to balance out that cash with some type of a hedge against the debasement of the currency, and gold makes the most sense in order to do that. So a core position in gold and a heavy, heavy dose of cash.
Okay. Yep. I like that. I've been preaching that since last year, and it's done well. So I'm like, okay. And then, so you have reports, indicators, and trade ideas, on your website. Can you just tell my audience the importance of something like that? Because everything's, you know, you go to your website, a lot of good information. You got blogs, you got videos, but then you have things that are locked. And I'm like, ooh, I want to unlock that. I want that.
Well, you know, so basically the locked stuff is, you know, so I try and put a blog post out every week. That's just free information that I put out just on some of the indicators and things that I use and some of the things I'm looking at. You know, the locked information or the subscription information, it's really just much more detailed stuff in that regard. So for every every asset class, whether it's stocks, bonds, gold, foreign equities. There's three or four major things that I try and pay attention to understand where I think prices are going to go. And that's fundamentals. What is the valuation, and how is are fundamentals improving? Are they degrading somehow? Sentiment, it would be number two. Are people overly bullish? Are they overly, excited about this asset class? Or is this one that's really out of favor? Because that's usually goes right along with the fundamental valuation. So things that are overvalued are usually overloved, and things that are undervalued and offer better opportunities are usually more hated and out of favor. And then technicals play a big part too. So I pay attention to, technical indicators, kind of traditional technical analysis, but also momentum is really important to me. And so I use a variety of those types of things. And then of course, macro, what's going on in the macro economy. And that would be a kind of the fourth leg on the trading table, as kind of Todd Harrison has talked about it. So really all those indicators are geared towards whatever it is, we're looking at gold. What do the fundamentals look like? What does sentiment look like? What are the technicals of it? Same thing with stocks. And so I try and just update those things to have a kind of a holistic picture of what to expect for different asset classes.
Okay. I think we are like on the exact same page with everything. And my trades, I'm like a walking RSI, where are we going? I'm macro. Where do we see in 5 years, 1 year? So a lot of, I think we're rowing the boat with our oars in the same direction, which is really good. And then to conclude, Jesse, is what would you like to tell my audience in regards to, I don't know, you want to scare them to death, or do you want to say everything is just okay? Let me just tuck you in. Don't worry about a thing.
Rather than be afraid of what the current situation looks like, I do think it's probably, I mentioned Stan Druckenmiller. A lot of these guys, Jim Rogers has for a while, Sam Zell, Carl Icahn. You look at the greatest investors of all time, and they are all Warren Buffett, has the biggest cash position in his career. They all look at this as the worst risk reward situation in the equity market that they've ever seen. And so that's important to recognize that right now is not a fantastic setup if you're an investor in the stock market. So I'm not saying that to scare anybody, but I guess the way I look at it is it probably means there's a terrific opportunity coming at some point over the next year, 2-3 years. And so if you're in a position to take advantage of that opportunity, rather than, be in the position of getting hurt before that time comes along, think about where you would rather be. And that's, I think, probably a way to help guide you think about how do I want to be positioned right now.
I couldn't have said it better. Thank you for saying it. And you guys, please, I'll leave a link in the description for his website. Follow it. Check out his blogs once a week, right, Jesse?
Yeah, Wednesday afternoons, I try and put something out every once a week, something like that.
And you're a Twitter guy, so
I'm heavy on Twitter. It's actually the only social media I'm still on, is because I have a wonderful network of people that provide me with valuable information on a daily basis. So I try and give back on a daily basis and put out kind of what I'm reading and finding of value.
Okay, yeah, and I'm just stuck in the tubes where it's all just the comment section. Twitter, not so much. I'm just like, it's all in the comment section, but yeah. And then reach out to Jesse on Twitter. I think that wraps it up. Thank you again, Jesse, for coming on, and you guys, we will see you tomorrow.